الحديث التاسع والعشرون, the 29th حديث. The 29th حديث is going to be speaking about صفات, the way to do the janabah. Okay, the way we need to do it. عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا اغتسل من الجنابة غسل يديه ثم توضأ وضوءه للصلاة ثم اغتسل ثم يخلل بيده شعره حتى إذا ظن أنه قد أروى بشرته أفاض عليه الماء 3 مرات ثم غسل سائر جسده. وكانت تقول كنت أغتسل أنا ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من إناء واحد نغترف منه جميعا. This hadith is narrated by Bukhari. Bukhari narrated this hadith in Kitab al-Ghusl. Imam Muslim narrated this hadith in Kitab al-Hayd. That's the first narration. The next one, which he brings, which Aisha says that me and the Prophet used to have a bath together, which is the next one, is narrated by Bukhari. And Bukhari narrated it in 4 places in his Sahih. He narrated in Kitab al-Ghusl, he narrated in Kitab al-Hayd, he narrated in Kitab al-Libas and Kitab al-I'tisam. So Kitab al-Ghusl, Kitab al-Hayd, Kitab al-Libas and Kitab al-I'tisam. Where's the other, the second way of hadith? Muslim narrated only in Kitab al-Hayd. Only Kitab al-Hayd. Aisha's tarjama, her biography, we took it in the third hadith. We took it when we were in the third hadith. Aisha says now, we're talking about how the Prophet used to do ghusl. Aisha said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا اغتسل. The messenger was one if he done ghusl. Huh? من الجنابة from جنابة. غسل يديه. First he would wash his hands. الله أكبر. He washed his hand, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Cleaned his hand properly. This is the sunnah to do ghusl. ثُمَّ تَوَضَّعَ وُضُوءَهُ لُلصَّلَةِ. The wudu is before the ghusl. Which one's first? What does that show you, brothers? That the touching the private part does not break your wudu. صح? If you're going to have the ghusl after, what's going to happen to your private part? You're going to have to touch your private part. The ghusl is after the wudu. So first of all, you do your wudu. Are you with me? Once you finish your wudu, then you go in and have a bath. The ghusl is after the wudu. First, the Prophet ﷺ used to wash his hands. Then he would do a full wudu. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what would he do? He would do a ghusl. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Thumma ghtasala. He would have a bath. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Thumma yukhallilu biyadihi sha'rahu. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he used to do was yukhallil. The word yukhallil is to put your hands in between your hair like this. Like that, to run your hands between your hair. And what's your intent? As if you've got hair. You run it between, inside your hair. The reason is because hadith mentions it. Ha? حَتَّى إِذَا ظَنَّ أَنَّهُ قَدْ أَرْوَى بَشَرَتَهُ. Until you believe you've touched your scalp. Skull. You just go in and you go in and make sure the water goes deep into the roots. He used to do that, alayhi salatu wasalam. Now pay attention. Pay attention. Some people just get water. And what happens? The water goes on their hair. And a lot of the times what happens, that water does not even reach your skull. The reason is because the water is hitting your head and it's flying off. It's smacking your head and it's just jumping off. It isn't really running down into your skull. So the hands are always needed. Even if you think you've got this new technology of how to shower, it doesn't. Unless you make it very slow, the water, you still require the water to go into, to reach it. Every part of your hair, you have to run your fingers through it. You see, that's how he used to do it. And until he believed that his skull is, again, brother, pay attention. The Prophet would take the water and he would put it in his head. He'd take the water like that. That's how he had a bath. And he would run that water inside. Brothers, the Prophet ﷺ is a wudu would not be this thing right now would exactly be the Prophet's wudu, ghusl. That's the ghusl he used to do, alayhi salam. When the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahabi told the Tabi'i, Tabi'i said, Wallah, I can't do it. Na'am, I can't do it, O Messenger. That's impossible. He said, Kana minka atwalu sha'ran. He had more hair than you. And he was bigger than you, alayhi salatu wasalam. Not wasting water. He would do that and make sure that water reaches every part. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You see, عليه الصلاة. This is غسل, not وضوء. غسل we're talking about. We can't even do وضوء with that. حتى إذا ظن أنه قد أروى بشرته أفاض عليها الماء ثلاث مرات. He would throw water over his hair, عليه الصلاة والسلام, three times. After he's made sure the water reaches the place, he'll take it, he'll put water over his hair three times, عليه الصلاة والسلام. After he's washed his hair, his head, عليه الصلاة والسلام, ثم غسل سائر الجسد. He washes the rest of his body. How do you wash the rest of your body, brothers? You do your right. You start with what? Your right. وكانت تقول عائشة used to say كنت أغتسل I used to what? Wash. أنا مي ورسول الله and the messenger من إناء in from one place. نغترف منه جميعا. We used to take it. نغترف ما معنا? The water, they used to stand in somewhere. They used to go and pick the water then. نغترف means to go and pick up the water like that. Get the water, pour it into themselves. They used to do that. نعم. The reason why you would wash your hands is why if the water is going to come out from where? It's coming out from somewhere outside, which is. Or using your hand. They used to use their hands. As I said to you, the Prophet used to use his hand. That's how he used to. So the word ikhtiraf means your palm. Just dip it in like that. We took it in the wudu. Now pay attention, brothers. If you're going to have to wash your head with your hands, and you've not washed your hands, it's wrong. So you wash it first, then you run that water that you've taken. Because remember, the water you have taken and run it through your hair. Now, fiqh al-hadith. البدء بغسل اليدين, starting with washing your hands first. قبل الوضوء, before you do wudu, أو الغسل, or even before you have a bath. You wash your hands first. Second thing that we take, the second fiqh that we take from the hadith is what? البدء بالوضوء, to start with the wudu, قبل الغسل, before you do غسل, سنة محمد, is the sunnah of the Prophet. Put the wudu first. And then you have the غسل, that's the sunnah of the messenger. استحباب, that is recommended, تخليل الشعر عند الغسل, to run the water with your hand, fingers, to run it through your hair, recommended, we take it. And it has three benefits for that. It has three benefits for you to run it. First is, it's easy for you the water to reach your hair. Or else when you go for a long, you're wasting a lot of water, maybe after a while the water might reach your skull. Are you with me? But this makes it quicker for the water to reach. So you won't be wasting a lot of water. Second one is, the hands touching your fingers will allow places which normally, even if the water did run it, that it will never have touched it. By just touching it with your hands, it definitely will become wet. By you running it through your fingers. And last one, which is, the water in which he brings to his head, تَأْنِيسُ الْبَشَرَةِ, it is to support the body and your skin or your head, the water in which you're using on it. خَشْيَةَ, fear that you may, that external water or something else may fly onto it. Like for example, some of the fuqaha believe if the water is used, you can't be reusing it again. It has to be, inshallah, which is going to come to us, that the water has to be purely something you know. If you've picked up the water with your own hand, and you've now placed and you've washed your hands, pure, your hands are clean, then you place it on your head, then definitely that's going to be what? Like, that's going to be definitely water that's going to be pure that reached your head. It saves you from any doubt of any other external form of water touching it. Four, istihbabu, that is recommended. إفاضة الماء على الجسد ثلاث مرات. That is recommended to pour the water over the body three times. Recommended. Five. the permissibility of a man and a wife, both of them to have ghusl together. Six, the permissibility of the wife and the husband to both be standing in one bath or one tub or one place, huh? And both of them getting the water for their own selves, for their own palms, huh? Getting it. Seven, the permissibility of the husband to look at his wife's awrah, and that the husband could look at the wife and the wife could look at the husband. Eight, mashru'iyyati, the permissibility, showing that dalkil a'da, ha, dalkil a'da means, huh, wiping the water over your body. So when you pour the water over, you don't just pour it and just leave it like that. You basically run your hands on your skin, ha. Because where do we get that from? That he touched his skin, which is that he poured the water, thumma ghasala. A father al-ma, he poured the water, thumma ghasala, and then he had a bath. What does that mean? Aydalak, of course, he touched his body. That's what it means. Nine, the permissibility we take from this, that the husband and the wife can have sexual intercourse both naked, fully naked. And all the narrations that some have brought, that the woman has to only be uncovered from, she has to be wearing her clothes and hidden, all of them are weak narrations. لا أصل له. It has no bad. لا يصح منه شيء. Sorry. لا يصح منه شيء. Nothing is authentic from it. Number 10. الغسل, it uplifts. الغسل من الجنابة على السنة, according to the sunnah, يرفع الحدثين. It removes the minor and the major hadith. The minor and the major. Ghusl removes the what? Minor and major hadith. Number 11. حسن خلق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومعاشرته لأهله. The good way that the Prophet lived with his wives. How he was also with his wives. Like it wasn't like some men get angry with their wives and you go have your own bath, leave me alone, what you got to do with me, leave me, why, leave me. And she has to go by herself, have her bath, he comes, la. The man, the Prophet was still happy, after even intimacy, he was still happy with his wives. He was having a bath with them, alayhi salam, good life. Al-Hadith al-Thalathun, the 30th Hadith. An Maymun bint al-Harith, radiyallahu ta'ala anha. زوج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رضي الله تعالى عنها زوج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنها قالت وضعت لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وضوء الجنابة فأكفى بيمينه على يساره مرتين أو ثلاثا ثم غسل فرجه ثم ضرب يده بالأرض أو الحائط مرتين أو ثلاثا ثم تمضمض واستنشق وغسل وجهه وذراعيه ثم أفاض على رأسه الماء ثم غسل سائر جسده ثم تنحى فغسل رجليه فأتيت بخرقة فلم يردها فجعل ينفض الماء بيده. This hadith, an Imam al-Bukhari narrated it, and it's his wordings. And he narrated it in Kitab al-Ghusl. Many places in Kitab al-Ghusl, like within Kitab al-Ghusl, many babs he narrated it in. Maybe 6-7 places in Kitabu. 7-8 places he brought this hadith. Muslim narrated the hadith in only Kitab al-Hayd, in one place in Kitab al-Hayd. The narrator of this hadith is the Prophet's wife, Maymunah bint Harith ibn Hazan al-Hilaliya, Umm al-Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers. Wa zawja Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she was the wife of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Zawajaha Rasulullah, the Prophet married her sanata sab'in, the 7th year of Hijriyah. وَمَرِضَتْ بِمَكَّةَ, she became ill in Mecca, فَحَمَلَتْ فَحُمِلَتْ حَتَّى دُفِنَتْ بِسَرَفٍ عَلَى أَمْيَالٍ مِنْ مَكَّةَ سَنَةَ إِحْدَى وَخَمْسِينَ. She got ill and in Mecca, she was carried a bit further and she died, رضي الله تعالى عنها, there. Like 51 miles from Mecca where she died. They buried her there. a place called Sarf. Bukhari and Muslim, Ashab al-Sunan and Misanid and all of them, they all brought her narrations. And the year in which she died, there is a lot of views regarding it. Maymuna bint Harith radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, وضعت, I placed لرسولillah, for the messenger of Allah, wudu al-janaba. I placed for the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wudu al-janaba. I placed for the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wudu al-janaba. What does it mean by the wudu of janaba? She means water for him to do ghusl. That's what she means. I placed for him. The wudu is something to him. So what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? فَأَكْفَى بِيَمِينِ عَلَى يَسَارِ. مَمَعْنَا فَأَكْفَى, we took that before. He poured the water slightly towards his right arm, alayhi sallam. You see, so when we go to the hadith of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala and how he done the wudu, and Abdullah ibn Zayd, how he done the wudu, see how they pushed it, peeled. Who did they take it from? Their teacher, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what is the sunnah? Don't come and put your hands inside the water. Sunnah is to pour it slightly, tilt it sideways, and then wash your hands, clean it. Place the water inside your fingers. Do it like this. When you finish, now put your hands inside it. So the Prophet ﷺ, he washed his hands. So we now know how he washed his hand. From him directly, عليه الصلاة والسلام. مرتيني, twice or three times. ثم غسل فرجه, then he washed his private part. What did he do? He washed his private part. ثم ضرب يده بالأرض. After he touched his private part, what did he do? He smacked his hands against the floor or the wall or the الحائط three times. And this is the reason, is because the Prophet ﷺ just done istinja, he purified himself, عليه الصلاة والسلام. So he's cleaning his hands, عليه الصلاة والسلام, from touching his private part. Then what did he do? ثم تمضمض. Then he poured water into his mouth, صلوات الله وسلام عليه. And then واستنشق. And he put water up his nose. And he brought them out, عليه الصلاة والسلام. وغسل وجهه وذراعي. He washed his face and his ذراع, his arms, عليه الصلاة والسلام. You see. ثم أفاض على رأسه الماء. And then he poured water over his head. ثم, and after that, his head, عليه الصلاة والسلام. ثم غسل سائر جسده, he washed all of his bodies. What was remaining for the wudu that he didn't do? His feet he didn't do. His feet is separate. He didn't done it. So then what did he do? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he washed his hands, as I said, three times or twice. Then he washed his what? His private part. It's clean now, his private part. Then what did he do, alayhi salatu wasalam? He done wudu, full wudu. Left what behind? His feet, he kept that aside, alayhi salatu wasalam. He washed all of his body, and then he washed the legs by itself. He went to the side, meaning he stepped out of where he was. ثم تنحى, the place he was standing, he moved away from it. And he washed the legs by itself, like itself. فغسل رجليه, he washed his two feet. Maymuna then said, فأتيت, I brought him a cloth. I brought him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. فلم يريدها, he didn't want it. He refused it from me. فجعل ينفض الماء بيده. So what did he, صلى الله عليه وسلم, he start to do? He, صلى الله عليه وسلم, got the water pouring away from his hands, عليه الصلاة والسلام, by doing this. Now, some of the ulama took from that part where he rejected Maymuna's cloth that is not good for the person to wipe the water off his face when he does wudu or when he does ghusl, that he shouldn't clean himself with that. Some scholars took from that. But that argument is weak because he has, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used it. He did use it in other narrations. Aisha radiallahu anha, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did use it. So what do we say? We'll say maybe Maymuna brought him a cloth he didn't like. Or it was dirty, or something was, maybe something was on it he didn't want. Or probably didn't even want it for that time. واضح? Fiqh al-hadith. The fiqh of the hadith. استحباب إعداد الماء وكذا اللباس للطهارة. To prepare, it's recommended for you to prepare your water and your clothes and everything you're going to wear before you go into the toilet. Don't shout, ah, I need water, it's car, help, help, ah, support me. My water finished. Some people do that, don't they? Or he doesn't even have no clothes, so what does he do? He comes out with his his towel. He's walking around the house. It's highly recommended that the person is organized. That's what our religion teaches us. So the wife also, to be a wife. Look at Islam, the construction and the way that Islam, the religion is based. The wife serves her husband. She brings him the water, she's concerned, clothes, get him his clothes ready, ironing stuff, that's her job. That's what her job isn't to be a CEO of a company and to be working outside. It's not her job. You see, not that I'm saying it's not allowed. If it doesn't go against any Sharia rulings or doesn't do anything wrong, of course she can become a CEO of a company or run a company. I don't know about if she can be CEO of a company. But I know she can work. She can work and she can do what she wants. But her obligation, and her responsibility is what? Her children and her husband. The same way his responsibilities and obligation on him is to go outside and make sure he suffices. He brings clothes for him to be ironed for. And that he brings food for her to cook for him. And that he brings, he pays for the bills, he pays for the water that's running in order for her to bring water. He has to provide. Now, that's how Islam. Number two, khidmatu zawjatu zawjaha. The second one, which is the woman serves her husband. Second point, she serves it. And that is obligatory on her, wajib. Wajib. The woman has to cook, wajib. Obligatory, she's an athima, she's a sinner if she doesn't. The woman has to serve her husband in the food and what he eats. And his clothing, she has to iron his clothes. It's obligatory, she can't, she's a sinner. All of these are wajib. Athima, she's a sinner if she doesn't do it. Because the same way it's wajib on the man to provide. Are you with me? For the man to what? To provide. Obligatory. Obligatory for him to do it. He's a sinner if he doesn't do it. And he doesn't provide for his wife food to eat, clothes to wear. Some men, they go outside, they're buying new clothes every day. They're buying themselves new watches. They're buying this and that. And the wife is on the same clothes that he married her with. She's wearing the same clothes. The best clothes that she has is her wedding clothes. That's the best clothes that she has. Nothing else. He doesn't buy for her. He's regularly going and buying himself new clothes. He's going to Zara. Yeah. He's buying himself new clothing. So it's reported that the man is aware of the wife and her buying her stuff. Number three, لا تدخل اليدين. Don't put both of your hands inside the water without washing it first. That is obligatory if he just woke up from sleep. It's obligatory. If he just woke up from sleep, he's not allowed to. We took that in the hadith before, right? But it's also highly recommended if you are awake all day, still don't put your hand inside it, just wash it. But if you woke up, we took the hadith. إِذَا اسْتَيْقَظَ أَحَدُكُمْ مِنْ نَوْمِ فَلَا يَجْعَلْ فِي يَدِهِ. If one of you wakes up, he should not place his hand في الإناء in a vessel. حَتَّى يَغْسِلْهَا. Until he washes it. Number four. استِحْبَابُ. That is recommended. استِعْمَالُ الْمُطَحِّرِ. It is recommended to use something to purify yourself. Like something to... Like what? Sand. The process of using the hand sand was like also a form of the nice smell that the normal, general, natural smell that the sand has. It does take the odor away from you, from your hand. The sand does it, the dust. It's very clean. It'll clean you very good. The smell will go. With water, it will clean it properly. Are you with me? And if nowadays, we've got perfumes and stuff like that, it's very good the person uses it. Five, البدء بغسل الفرج قبل البدء بالوضوء أو الاغتسال لإزالة الأذى. To start with the private part, before going for your wudu, or ikhtisalu, or also washing yourself with what? Yourself. That you should, ikhwani billahi alaykum, ponder one thing. Look at this, Allahu Akbar. The muhaddith, the person who knows the hadith, what will he be able to do? His fiqh is more stronger, right? Look at the previous narration, there are things in this narration that isn't in the previous narration. And the more the person knows more hadith, the more he sees what? Additional things that are in this one, that's not in this one, that's in this sahih. You know what I mean? And that his comprehension is more stronger than many other people. Because he say this is this was, the other one was a bit general, this was more specific, going in more in details. Because the Prophet has a hadith, not all of them did he, was explained in same issue by his wives. Each wife would add something to it she saw from it. And with all those narrations bringing it together, it will allow you to have a bigger picture, a bigger understanding, a bigger fiqh. So this is why we always say Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani was a faqih. He was a? The reality is that's how it is. He was a faqih, rahimahullah. And that is not as it's made to look like. Number six, istihbabu هذه الصفة في الغسل من الجنابة. Istihbab, that is recommended. This characteristics is recommended. That the Prophet did the way he did it when a person is doing غسل من الجنابة. Recommended. Purify, having a bath from janaba, these characteristics, the way the Prophet did it, is recommended. Number seven, تأخير delaying غسل الرجلي, to delay the washing of the feet. يكون لمن يبقى عند رجليه ماء لا يجري. And this is for a person. It is a for a person لمن يبقى عند رجليه ماء, is a person who's using water that's not flowing. Then what's the case in that situation? Like us nowadays, the water's running. So which one's better? It's better that the water is, the legs are washed with the wudu, and not after. That you do with the wudu that you've just finished, you wash the legs, then you come in and you have your wudu. If the water is running, that is recommended, according to the ulama currently now. Eight. The permissibility of using a cloth to dry yourself. The pouring of the water, how do you take the water? The next point. Taking a water from the place, if you took the water from your place, how are you going to put it in your private part? You would take the water with your right, pour it into your left, and pour it from, and that's what you're going to do in your private part. The virtue of Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala anha in serving her husband, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and honoring him. Naam.